morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Excuse me while I adjust my hearing aid. The problem is, I'm sorry. This is the third Sunday of Advent, time of expectant preparation assignment for a babe full of promise and hope whose birth story we're going to hear, of course, this morning from our cast of young people and adults. Thank you, Sam and Jim. So let's open our ears, let's open our eyes, let's open our hearts and our minds to the readings and song and message that our children will bring to us this morning, aware that we are coming together in an extended time of COVID trauma, and it has left us collectively wounded and uncertain. Here in the presence of God, may our individual and collective experiences, losses, and scars encounter significant healing, and may we find comfort and give comfort to one another, and do that as we journey on toward Bethlehem. So let us rejoice. Let us give thanks for the many blessings God has bestowed upon us. And let us begin by joining together and turning to our hymnal to 117 and singing the angels from the anxieties and cares that are in your heart and mind. let it go. Giving all your worries and anxieties to God, who cares deeply about you. And then breathe in again that breath of God. Let it fill your lungs. Fill your heart. As you do, connect your spirit with God's spirit. Continue to prepare for the celebration of the birth of Jesus Christ, who comes. That our condition of our heart is more valuable than any earthly possession. He demonstrated pure and sincere compassion toward us all. He lived a life of service and devotion. Jesus, born of flesh and blood, and as the Apostle Paul put it, declared to be Son of God according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. Thanks be to God. Will you join me in prayer? Dear Lord, help us to not overlook you this Christmas season. Help us to simplify our activities, agendas, and intentions so we may focus our celebrations on you. In a world full of worry and dismay and catastrophe, help us to find your peace and good news. This Christmas, make it real in our heart as we share the story of your amazing grace. Now, as our service continues, as Mary Owens and Mark Jeter come forward to light the Advent candle of love in Bethlehem on our wreath, I want to warn you that when we sing O Come, Emmanuel on 116 and Black Pilgrim Hymnal, the text is on page 117 at the top. Beautiful. Thank you.
We light the purple candle of hope and prophecy. And the pink candle of joy and Zechariah. And now we light another purple candle, the candle of love and death. God's word in Micah chapter 5, verse 2 says, Bethlehem, you are one of the smallest towns of the nation of Judah, but the Lord will choose one of your people to rule your nation. It will be someone whose family goes back to ancient times. In our hymn, O Come, Emmanuel, verse 6 opens with the words, O come, O day spring, come. Day spring is a metaphor for Christ. In Revelation 22, verse 16, Christ says, I am the brightest morning star. This is the last star that is seen as darkness turns to dawn.
Today's Christmas program is entitled A New Star. Jesus is our new star, our day spring star. His love carries us through our darkest times and brings us into a light that is possible only through his love. Please join in singing only verse 6 of Come, O Come, Emmanuel.
Thank you. faint fire on the mountains of the big field. Aren't we blessed to have such a wonderful water? Our scripture reading for today is from Luke chapter 1, verses 26 through 38. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent to God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. This is the scripture for today. May we hear the word of God in it for us. And now we present to you our Christmas program, A New Star.
Nazareth.
Is Nazareth a place in the sky, you know?
up in space?
No, it's a place down on Earth, on that little bitty planet right down there.
You mean the one over there by Jupiter?
No, a little further to the right.
Do you mean Pluto?
I didn't think he was still a planet.
No, not Pluto, to the right.
Your other right.
You mean that little blue and green one? There between Mars and Venus?
Exactly. And look, right over there is the little town of Nazareth.
Oh, who's the pretty lady?
That's Mary. She's a virgin, and she is pledged to be married to a man named Joseph. Joseph is a carpenter, and he is also a righteous man.
What's he doing?
Building something. Carpenters are always building something.
I hope it's a cradle.
I think you're getting ahead of our story.
Who's the other guy? He's all shiny, like us.
That's Gabriel. He's an angel. He has come to talk to Mary. Let's listen.
Greetings. You are highly favored. The Lord is with you. Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of Most High.
How will this be, since I am not married?
The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she will, who was said to be barren in her sixth month, for nothing is impossible with God.
I am the Lord's servant. May it be as you have said.
What did all that mean? The angel told Mary that she is going to have a baby who will be the Son of God.
And what did Mary say?
She said, yes!
Oh, good. Now what? I like her. She seems really nice.
Oh, she is. After the angel left her, Mary hurried to visit her cousin, Elizabeth.
Elizabeth! Mary!
When Mary arrived, she found out that things were just like the angel had told her.
Mary seems really happy to see Elizabeth. And just think, Elizabeth was going to have a baby in her old age. It was a miracle.
Yes, and Mary wasn't the only one who was happy. Elizabeth was happy too. Listen to what she said to Mary.
Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear.
But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord would come to me?
My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name.
Mary stayed with Elizabeth for a long visit and then returned home to Nazareth. But by now, it was more obvious that she was going to have a baby.
Uh-oh, what did Joseph say?
Well, Joseph knew the baby wasn't his, but since Joseph was a righteous man, he decided to put Mary away privately. But after he had considered these things, God sent an angel to speak to him in a dream.
Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are going to give him the name Jesus, because he will save people from their sins.
All of this was done in fulfillment of the ancient prophecy. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel. Oh, and the name Emmanuel means God with us.
Wow, that's a great name. What did Joseph do when he woke up?
He did just what the angel told him to do.
Okay, so what happened next?
Next, there was a little drama that went on in Rome. Caesar, the Roman ruler, ordered that everyone had to be counted.
Why would he do that?
Something about taxes, whatever those are. But in order to be counted, everyone had to go back to their family's hometown.
Sort of like a family reunion.
A little bit, but without the games or potato salad.
That's too bad. I love potato salad. Did they have cookies? I love cookies too.
I don't think so.
Then it really wasn't much like a family reunion at all.
No. In fact, for Mary and Joseph, it was a pretty long and difficult trip, especially since Mary was expecting a baby.
Where did they have to go?
They went to a little town called Bethlehem.
Do you mean that little bitty town over there in the middle of nowhere?
That's the one. It was the birthplace of Joseph's ancestor, King David.
Wait a minute. Bethlehem, isn't that the one they sing about? The one they say, oh, little town of Bethlehem.
Yes.
I really like that song. They even sing about how the silent stars go by. But listen, I thought this was a story about the first Christmas, when we get to the part with the trees and the star.
There was no tree on the first Christmas, but there was a star.
Where?
We're getting there. First, we have to hear more about Mary and Joseph.
Okay.
So, Joseph went to Bethlehem to be counted, and Mary went with him.
Look, Mary and Joseph have arrived in Bethlehem. I hope they have somewhere nice to stay. Mary looks very tired.
You're right, but there was no room for them in the inn, so Mary and Joseph stayed in the stable.
A stable? Do you mean like for cows and horses and goats and sheep and...
Yep. Mary and Joseph stayed in a humble stable. There Mary had her baby, and she wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in the manger.
Why did they put the baby in a manger?
It was probably the safest and best place they had for him. I'm sure that Joseph landed with fresh new hay and stood watch over Mary and the baby during the night.
What did they name the baby?
They named him Jesus, which means the Lord saves. And now for the first time up in the sky, there was a new star announcing the birth of the Messiah.
Just think, a new star in the sky? How wonderful, how glorious. No one on earth could have missed that.
It's amazing that not only did people miss the Messiah then, but they still miss him today. Maybe it's because they aren't really looking for the Messiah. But God didn't rely on a single new star to announce the birth of his son. He also sent an angel to tell a group of shepherds all about it. Of course, it really frightened the shepherds to see an angel.
Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger.
Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, so they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about the child, and all who heard it were amazed by what the shepherds had said to them. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
So that's the story of the first Christmas and the star.
Yes, but there is more to the story. Look, over there in the east.
Who are they?
They are the three wise ones. But they can tell us themselves.
We three kings of Orient are.
Me is the traveler far.
Field and fountain, moor and mountain, following yonder star.
Wait a minute. What are they saying?
It's from a song about three wise ones. They're saying that they are three kings from the east and that they've traveled a long way to get here.
Oh, I get it. and they saw a new star, and they followed it because they were wise enough that it meant the Savior had been born. Oh, I like the kings. And look, they brought presents. Who are they for?
The gifts are for the baby Jesus. They are gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Gold, because Jesus is the king. Frankincense, because he is the high priest, and myrrh, because of his sacrifice. So the wise ones went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they gave him their gifts and went back to their own countries.
That's amazing. And how do you know all of this?
Oh, I saw it all from up here in the sky. You see, I am the new star that appeared that night.
Really? You are the new star? But you're so old.
So, the story. It's over 2,000 years old. But it is as true today as it was on that very first Christmas. And that's why we still celebrate Christmas today.
That's amazing. Thank you for telling me this story. I think I will shine a little brighter now that I know all of this.
Well, you know what King David said. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they display knowledge. There is no speech or language where their voice is not heard. Their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world.
Yeah, well said. Hey, is that the same King David?
Yes, King David, the ancestor of Joseph, the one who was born in Bethlehem all those years ago.
Wow, I like that guy. He has a real way with words. So, what now? Can we have cookies? I love cookies.
Yes, yes. We'll get you some cookies. Come on.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for that. That was wonderful. And kind of a star-pointed message of Jesus and his birth. A great big thanks to Jenny and to Sam for all their work, their time, their effort, and parents as well, and friends and family for being here. A lot of energy put into this amazing thing. Let's give them another round of applause. Now let's join our hearts together in prayer. We thank you for the message our young people have brought to us this morning in such creative fashion, O God. So we come to you with thankful praise and in joy of who and what you are, unbreakable, persistent, self-giving love, made known most fully in your Son, our Savior and Lord, Christ Jesus. We give you thanks for the message of the Incarnation. And we ask that you will bless us with your favor and encouragement in our time as we flesh out the words of Scripture and make them credible in our lives in the way we live. This morning we remember with great concern and care many people across the 6 to 8 states the tornadoes ripped through last night. The people who lost their lives, we commend to your care. Those who survived, families and friends, pray that you would embrace them with your love. That you would journey with them through their sense of loss and grief. We give you thankful praise for first responders who have worked fearlessly and continually seeking to rescue and to find those who are beneath all the debris. We pray for the safety of those who are under so much waste. We ask that you would be with all of those places that have suffered the loss of life and the loss of livelihood, the loss of a home. Pray that you would be with them in the months and years ahead as they rebuild. And thank you so much for the outpouring of concrete expressions of love and concern from around the world for all the help that is flowing and enable us to do our small part. We would remember to you also those on the island of Oahu. They have gas in their water board because of our inattentiveness to how we're all related, even to this good earth where you planted us and given us to care for. We pray that you would enable, by all means, a resolution to the water crisis that they are facing. Pray that you would be with all those who earnestly work for peace, who deliberately live on less in order to share with those who have less than they need. All those who make it their business to plead the cause of the orphan, the prisoner, and the oppressed. And all who stand up in any company to challenge racial slurs and violence against people of color, immigrants, and aliens, and all that. Well, God, you have told us clearly in the drama of Bethlehem that words alone will do. So help us to productively be what we say and that what we are and do might become ruined. Bless our rhetoric outruns our needs. Finally, we ask that you would teach us to live the prayer our Lord taught us, whose disciples saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine stand now and join together in singing our closing hymn that came upon the midnight clear, number 121. Faith, hope, and love be and abide with you today and all your tomorrows.